Dear students, welcome to EPG Patashala. My name is Professor G. Vedaparayana, retired from the Department of Philosophy, SV University, Tirupati. The paper that we are going to deal is Indian Religion and Philosophy, and the module that I am going to teach now is the system of Vaisheshika, one of the Indian schools. And this school is a very important school of the Astika Darshanas, and it is also related to the other system called Nyaya. Nyaya is epistemological and this is metaphysical, and they are mutually dependent, and they are also called syncretic systems. And we are now going to see what is the philosophy that is there in this system. So these are the learning objectives that you are seeing on the board, that is the metaphysics, and we are going to talk about these seven kinds of categories in that, and then the metaphysical part of it, atomism, and also bondage and liberation, and lastly we give a summary or the gist of this system. So as a part of introduction, Vaisheshika system is a very old system in the sense it is next only to Sankhya system, which is the oldest in the Indian systems, and it is much earlier to Nyaya Vaisheshika system. Nyaya system, why we are saying that is, Nyaya, though related to Vaisheshika, Nyaya is of a very late origin when compared to Vaisheshika system. So the word Vaisheshika means Vishesha. This is derived from the word Vishesha, which means particularity or essence of things. So sage Kanada is the founder of this system. He was called Kanada because he used to live as an ascetic by eating kanas or grains. Food grains are like particles. So Kana also means particular. And one who lives on the philosophy of particularity. What does it mean? Philosophy of particularity means everything is a particular substance. It has its own existence. This is the thesis of this philosophy. So, Kanada wrote Vaisheshika Sutra. This is the major or first source of this system. And Prashastapada has written a commentary on it, on Vaisheshika Sutra, which is known as Padartha Sangraha. And Udayana and Sridhara have written commentaries on the Padartha Dharma Sangraha. So, Vaisheshika philosophy is a pluralistic realism, and it is a philosophy of diversity, and diverse kinds of souls are there in this universe. Thus, Vaisheshika was fused with Nyaya, and as I have already said, thus these two systems together called systems of Samanantara, which means they are allied systems, they are syncretic systems. So these two schools, that is Nyaya and Vaisheshika, have the same aim, namely liberation of the individual self from ignorance. And right knowledge of the reality is the means of liberation. And there is, however, some differences between these two systems. That is, Nyaya accepts four independent sources of knowledge, namely perception, inference, comparison and testimony. Whereas Vaisheshika recognizes only two sources, that is perception and inference. And because this is mainly a metaphysical system, they do not elaborate on these two systems. They accept whatever they have. Nyaya has said about this two means of perception. So now we come to the metaphysics part of it. So Vaisheshika ontology, ontology is otherwise known as metaphysics. Ontology accepts seven categories. Categories in Sanskrit are called padarthas, which comprehend all the reals. Category means the object denoted by a word. It also means that all objects of knowledge or all reals denoted by words. So word and the reality are intimately connected according to this system. So reals are divided into two classes, namely being and non-being. That is in Sanskrit bhava and abhava. So being stands for all positive realities such as existent particular things or physical things, and also mind and soul, etc. Which means they have physical things or psychological things or spiritual things. And non-being stands for all negative facts like the non-existence of things. This is called abhava. Then there are altogether six kinds of being and one kind of non-being. So together, padarthas are seven. First one is substance, second quality, third action, fourth generality, fifth particularity, sixth relation of inherence, and the last one is non-existence. And you know the Sanskrit equivalents of it, which are given in brackets. Now we take up the first kind of category. Category in the sense substance, that is. Substance is that in which quality or action can exist. Substance is distinct from both quality and action, which cannot exist without substance. So substance is the substratum of the qualities and actions. This is the way how we can say this, that substance is independent of all the qualities and actions in various words. The substance is the substratum of qualities and actions. It is also the material cause of the other composite things produced from it. For instance, the threads are the material cause of cloth, which is composed of things formed by the threads. So there are nine kinds of substances, namely earth, water, light, air, ether, time, space, soul, and mind. So of these, the first five are called physical elements, that is panchabhutas, five physical elements, since each of them possesses a specific quality called vishesha, which is sensed by an external sense organ. So smell is the peculiar quality of the earth, and taste is the peculiar quality of water, color is the peculiar quality of light, touch is the peculiar quality of air, and sound is the peculiar quality of ether, that is akasha. So those five specific properties are sensed by the five external senses, that is, the sense of smell is constituted by the element of earth, the sense of taste by water, the sense of sight by light, that of touch by air, that of hearing by ether. So the substance of the earth is there in all other substances because they have the quality of smell. This is the peculiar quality of earth. Earth is there in every other substance. The substance of earth, water, light, and air are of two kinds. They are eternal and non-eternal, that is Nitya and Anitya. The eternal kind of earth, water, light, and air are those which are constituted by the atoms. Atoms are called paramanus in Sanskrit, which are partless and can neither be produced nor destroyed. That is, atoms are eternal. They are not produced even by God. They exist by itself. We cannot go for explanation of it. We have to accept it. The non-eternal kind of earth, water, light, and air are those which are produced by the combination of atoms and therefore subject to disintegration or destruction. The atoms are imperceptible and so known by inference. We can't see them. Atoms are so small, so subtle that no sense organ can see them. Therefore, we have to infer that there are atoms by seeing the objects that are very, very large. So they are also, different kinds of atoms are there depending upon the objects. So there are four kinds of atoms, namely atoms of earth, water, light, and air. And ether or akasha, the fifth substance, is the substratum of the quality of sound. And sound is perceived, but ether cannot be perceived. Space and time are also imperceptible substances. They are also all-pervading like ether. Time is inferred from our cognitions of the past, present, and future, older and younger. Although indivisible and one, either space and time are distinguished into different parts. Then the soul, Atma, is an eternal and all-pervading substance. which is the substratum of the phenomena called consciousness. So, souls are of two kinds, namely individual souls and universal souls, that is jivatmas and paramatmas. Former is mentally perceived as possessing some quality when, for instance, one says, I am happy, I am sorry, and so on. These things are, revealed the, existence of the jivatma. The latter is one and is inferred as it is, inferred as the creator of the world. As the creator of the world, world is there, therefore we have to suppose that there must be eternal soul who has created these non-eternal souls. And manas is also a kind of substance which is the internal sense, antar indriya. See, other, five pancha gnanendriyas are external, we can see them. But manas is the sixth sense organ which we cannot see, but without which the sense organs cannot have knowledge at all. It is only when the sense organs have a relation with the manas, that is internal sense organ, then only we can know something outside or we can have the knowledge of objects. So it is the basis for our perception of the individual soul and its qualities like pleasure, pain. It is also atomic and imperceptible. What manas? Manas is all atomic and imperceptible. And its existence is inferred from the following grounds. Okay, these have been, next we will go to the quality. Quality cannot exist independently by itself, but inheres in the substance. It is not constitutive cause of anything. Quality cannot produce anything because it is dependent on the substance. So, category of quality is called an independent reality because it can be conceived, thought and named independently of a substance. So, it is in this sense that it is called independent reality. Not that it can exist by itself, but we can know it apart from the substance. So, they include both mental and material qualities. Quality, substance is of two kinds, that is mental qualities and material qualities. A quality is the static and permanent feature of a substance. For Kanada, there are 17 qualities and Prashastapada has added 7 more to them. We need not go into those particulars. And for Nyaya Vaisheshika school, there are altogether 24 qualities and they are of mental as well as material character, such as pleasure, pain, smell, touch and so on. So, next we are going to another kind of substance that is called action. Like quality, the category of action inheres in a substance, which means quality cannot be there independent of substance. Quality like action is always associated with the substance and it cannot exist apart from the substance, as I have already said. Unlike quality, which is static and a permanent feature of a substance, action is a dynamic and transient feature. See, quality, it cannot move by itself. It cannot come out of the substance, whereas action is not there in the substance. It is either given to it or somebody has to put a stop to the action of the substance. Therefore, it is not inherent in the substance. So, action is also cause of conjunction and disjunction. If substance is related to other substance, if it is conjoined, it means action is necessary. Substance by itself cannot go and unite with others. And at the same time, substance cannot separate itself from other substance by itself. Some action should be there, external action should be there for substance to be separated from other substance. So, action is also is of 5 kinds. We can say these action is upward movement, downward movement, contraction, expansion and locomotion. See, these are the general categories of these action. Next, we go to the generality. Generality or universality is a class concept or a class existence which is the common characteristic of things which falls under the same class. So this is a general understanding that if we see a group of things having the same kind of quality, we say there is a generality called cowness, there is a generality called whiteness, like that. And it is different from the genus, which stands for the class and includes the subclasses. So generality doesn't have subclasses like the genus have. So it is different from a genus. Generality stands for, I mean, not for the class, but for the common characteristics of certain individuals, and does not include subclasses. So this is the main difference between generality and genus. It may also be called as referring to a class, because it is the universal by the possession of which different individuals are referred as belonging to one class. So generality is one and eternal and residing in many. For instance, humanity is the generality or the class essence of all human beings. So it is the universal of the human being that is there in all human beings. So this is the general characteristics or the essential characteristics of particular things. Then, talking something more about this category called generality, it is Kanada calls generality and particularity as relative to thought, but they are not mere subjective concepts of our mind. Both are objective realities. See, for Vaisheshika, everything has an objective reality. Everything you take, therefore, there it is called a philosophy of realism, pluralistic realism rather. So the generality is external, shared by many particulars, and also it is a universal, residing in substances, qualities and actions. So it is not residing only in substances, but it is there in qualities and actions also. We can see many actions and say that this is the general characters of all these actions. And we can see some qualities and say that these are the general characteristics of particular object. So the higher is that of a being which includes everything and itself is not included in anything. That is satta, that is being. If you hear a word being, that is the highest generality. It doesn't go into the category of any other thing. Everything has to come under it, but it doesn't belong to anything as a part. So the lower generality is that which covers only a limited number of things. In Indian philosophy, there are three theories regarding universals. They are nominalism, conceptualism, and realism. So let us see what is the meaning of nominalism. Particularly in Buddhist philosophy, nominalism means universalities or generalities or mere names. They have no existence of their own. Particular existence doesn't belong to universality. Nominalism means it's a mere name. Then conceptualism, taken by Jainism and Vedanta, they say universal is not a mere name, but a reality which exists apart from our mind in the particulars only. See the subtle way of putting it. It exists apart from our mind, and at the same time, it exists in a particular object only. It has got objective reality, but it is not something very universal. It is there related to particularity, but at the same time, it is independent of my mind. So therefore, it is called conceptualism. As a concept, it is there independent of our mind. Then we come to realism of the Nyaya Vaisheshika, the system that we are talking about. According to this school, the universals are as objectively real as particulars, and they exist independently of our mind and also the particulars, which means these generality is there independent of my mind and independent of the object also. So in two ways it is independent. Then we go to particularity. What does it mean? Particularity signifies every individual is a single and a unique thing, different from others. Anything, you take two objects of the same kind, those two objects are independent of each other. It is peculiar to itself, and another thing is peculiar to itself. You take two human beings, they are human beings, no doubt, but each individual is distinct, each individual is particular and different from other individual. And particularity enables to perceive things as being different and unique from one another. So everything is unique. It has its own independent existence, even though it has some similarity with others. So particularity is opposed to generality, and it is exclusive, whereas generality is inclusive. See that what is meant by inclusive and exclusive. When we talk about particularity, it is exclusive of other things. If you talk about generality, generality is inclusive of many other things. So composite objects are not particulars, for they are composed of parts. So particularity doesn't apply to things which are having parts, which are composed of many other things. So it doesn't have a distinct existence of its own, because if you remove the parts, that object ceases to exist. So therefore it doesn't have a particular existence, a unique discrete existence. And only ultimate, simple and eternal substances like atoms and souls are particulars, and they are both quantitatively and qualitatively different from one another. So this is one of the important things that you have to bear in mind. The substances like atoms and souls, they are highly particular realities. In the sense, they are qualitatively and quantitatively different from each one. And Nyayavaisheshika realism is both quantitative and qualitative pluralism. What does it mean? Pluralism means every object is having its own existence, and it is different from other object qualitatively and quantitatively also. This is the meaning of it. Then last, seventh category is non-existence. This is what we have called abhava. Abhava means the disappearance of the object, which is not there. Anything is not there. But at the same time, the peculiarity of the Vaisheshika philosophy is, even this non-existence is a category. It has its own existence. This is the how they explain it. Seventh and last category, namely non-existence, that is abhava, is neither positive nor absolute like other categories, but negative and relative in its conception. It is related to some other thing, and also it is completely negative and not positive. Absolute negation is an impossibility and a pseudo idea. Negation necessarily presupposes some affirmation, which means there we should say that it is not an absolutism in the sense that there is something called absolute negation. Negation means saying that something was there and now it is not there. That is the relative way of putting the reality of non-existence according to Vaisheshika system. So absolute negation is an impossibility. And Vaisheshika realism regards non-existence as a separate category, because it treats the knowledge of negation as being different from the thing negated. This is what I mean. I want to just give a brief explanation. The thing negated is different from the knowledge that I have about the thing negated. So therefore, it has its own existence. As a knowledge, the abhava or non-existence of the thing is there in my mind as an independent entity. Mental entity, it is there. Even though I am talking about the non-existence of the object. So absence of an object and knowledge of its absence are entirely different. This is what we have to bear in mind when we justify that non-existence is also a category. Then there are four kinds of non-existence. That is antecedent non-existence, subsequent non-existence, and mutual non-existence and absolute non-existence. See, just now I have told that absolute non-existence is not, cannot be there according to this philosophy. But again, they have categorized it as one of the kinds of non-existence. I mean, absolute non-existence. Antecedent non-existence means, that is Pragabhava. Pragabhava means the thing was not there and then it has come now into existence. First is the non-existence of the thing before its production. It was not there. Just now it is produced, therefore it is there. Before the production of it, it was not there. And second kind of non-existence of a thing is, it is after its destruction. If I destroy a pot, then its existence is called non-existence after its destruction. And third is the non-existence of a thing as another thing. See, something is not another. So, example, we can give it that fire is not water. So, therefore, there is no existence of fire in water or water in fire. So, both are non-existence each other. Therefore, it is called the third kind of non-existence. A fourth kind of non-existence is, it is called pseudo-idea, such as the absence of a relation between two things in the past, present and future. We can't find any relationship between two things, either in the past or in the present or in the future. Therefore, this kind of fourth kind of bhava is a pseudo kind of idea. You cannot say that that kind of non-existence is there, even though we can just suppose it. We cannot justify it. So, to illustrate these four kinds of non-existences, for instance, a pot does not exist before its production. And second is, it does not exist after its destruction. Even pot is destroyed, it is not there. And it does not exist as cloth. Can there be pot which is in the form of cloth? No, cloth can never become a pot. I mean, cloth never become a pot, or pot can never become a cloth. This is the mutual non-existence of things. And fourth is, it doesn't exist as a liquid pot. This is an absurdity. Is there any pot made up of water or made up of oil? So, therefore, that is a pseudo idea, non-existence, which is a very, impossibility, like a square or round square. It's a contradiction in terms. Next, we go to atomism. This is another important topic in the metaphysics of Vaisheshika system. As I have already made it clear that Vaisheshika is purely ontological and metaphysical system, whereas Nyaya is an epistemological system which are related to each other. So, for epistemology, Vaisheshika is dependent on Nyaya system, and Nyaya for its metaphysics is dependent on this Vaisheshika system. So, now see, let us see what is atomism, and this topic comes even in the philosophy or system of Nyaya also. So, we will deal with this topic called atomism now. Vaisheshika says that the material objects are composed of parts which are further divisible into smaller parts. So, you take any material object, you cannot say that it cannot be divided. You can break it into several parts, and the ultimate part that remains is atom. Smaller parts are the minute particles of matter which may not be further divisible. This individual, partless, eternal particle is called atom. Atom is called Paramanu, and it is very interesting to say that these philosophies or these philosophers of Vaisheshika have talked about atomism in ancient times itself. Now, physics has been talking about atom, subatomic reality and all that. But these people have talked about Paramanu Siddhanta some thousands of years back. So, creation here means the combination of atoms in different proportions, and destruction means disassociation or dissolution of such a combination of atoms. And atoms are eternal, and they are neither produced nor destroyed. See, you can destroy objects, but they remain in the form of particles and they mix into other kinds of particles. That is, part particles are still there, but we cannot see them. We can only infer them. Because part particles are there, we can prepare a part. Because human being particles are there in this universe, we are able to produce human beings by means of a natural biological course. And they are neither produced nor destroyed, and it is only the atomic combination which are produced or destroyed. So this is an important thing. Only combinations are destroyed or brought together, not the atoms. So it is only the atomic combination which are produced or destroyed. The combinations are not essential nature of the atoms, and they are not pre-existent in the atom. See, this association, dissociation are not there in the atoms. Atoms are four kinds, that is earth, water, fire and air, and there is another element called ether. Ether does not have any, atoms, but it only helps for the atoms to come together or get dissociated. And there is no fifth kind of atoms, as I said, because the ether is not atomic. Ether is one and all pervading. Ether works as the medium for the combination and dissolution of the atoms. So atoms differ from one another both in quality and quantity. As I have already referred to this point, that atoms are so particular, are so distinct, are so peculiar to itself, that they are, each atom is different from other atom both qualitatively and quantitatively. So each atom has a particularity of its own and exists separately as a reality. Qualities of atoms are eternal, and atoms of air are the finest of all atoms, and they have the quality of touch. Atoms of fire possess the quality of touch and color, both. Atoms of water possess three kinds of quality, that is touch, color and taste. And atoms of the earth possess four kinds of qualities, namely touch, color, taste and smell. So atoms of earth are bigger than other atoms. These are not so subtle when compared to atoms of other kinds of substances. And besides these qualities, all atoms have the qualities of velocity. Velocity means they travel, and distinctness and number. You can count the particles or atoms as we count numbers. This is one atom, this is two atom, three atom, like that. Because they are very, very divisible and they are particulars. They also possess the primary as well as secondary qualities. And they are spherical or global or in shape, and they are eternal as the souls are. They are inactive and motionless in themselves, but provided some movement is caused to them, then they move for combination. So during creation, they are active and they remain inactive during dissolution. They derive motion from the unseen power, that is adrishta, or merit or demerit, which resides in the individual souls. Atoms are super sensible. What does it mean? Atoms are super sensible means no sense organs can sense them. It is beyond five sense organs. We can only infer their existence, as I have already said. And they combine in geometrical progress and not in arithmetical one, not 1 plus 1, but exponential growth is there. They increase by multiplication and not by mere addition. See the difference? Not by mere addition, but by multiplication. 2 into 4, not just 2 plus 2, 4. So when motion is imparted to them by the unseen power, they come together. And a dyad is minute, short and imperceptible. What is a dyad? Dyad is a combination of two atoms, and triad is a combination of three atoms. A triad is great, A triad is great, that is mahat, long and perceptible. See, here again, Vaisheshikas are talking about that it is possible to see a particular kind of atom that is called triad, because it is a combination of three atoms. So, therefore, it is perceptible. Combination of triads progresses geometrically till the gross elements of earth, water, fire and air arise. See, all the elements are composed of atoms. So, Vaisheshika atomism cannot be called just materialism, because it admits the reality of the spiritual substances, namely gods and souls. See, another thing, it is not only material atoms are there, even spiritual atoms are there. These are the two spiritual atoms, that is God and soul. They are also atomic in the sense we can't see them, because we can't see soul, we can't see God. We should say that they are the perfect imperceptible atoms. It is also, it subscribes to the law of karma. What is the law of karma? This is the unseen power. It is because of this unseen karma that these atoms come together or they get dissociated. And God is the efficient cause in bringing these atoms together or breaking their combination. And God himself cannot do this on his own. It is only when unseen power instigates God, then only God acts as the efficient cause for coming atoms together or making dissolving the atoms. So God assisted by the unseen power, production and destruction takes place. So the world presupposes the moral order also. It is not just a material world. There is underlying a material, ethical perspective is there behind this world. So unseen power consists of merits and demerits of the individual souls. As soul bears fruit of their actions as enjoyment or suffering, atoms are only the material cause of the world. In producing or destroying the world, God is guided by the law of karma, representing the unseen power of merits and demerits. Unseen power is unintelligent and needs God as the controller. So God doesn't create atoms or souls. Just as God is independent, existing on his own, souls and atoms are also eternal. They are not created, they cannot be destroyed. This is the common characteristic between God, soul and atoms. They are co-present and co-eternal with God. As long as God is there, atoms are there. As long as there is the moment there is no God, there cannot be atoms. They are co-present and co-eternal. This is what is meant by co-present and co-eternal. So God simply gives motion to the atoms and gives original impetus for their combination and the creation of the world. So then this is another important part of Vaisheshika metaphysics or ontology, that is bondage and liberation, how the person gets into bondage, that is suffering, and how he can be liberated. Let us see what the Vaisheshika system is going to say about it. So Vaisheshika says bondage is due to ignorance, that is leading to suffering. Just as all Indian philosophies say, ignorance is the main cause of suffering and knowledge is the main cause of liberation. So due to ignorance, man performs actions which are of merit and demerit. Meritorious actions are those which are in conformity with the Vedic injunctions, and demeritorious actions are those which are prohibited by the Vedas. See, here I want to make one point clear, that Vaisheshika system is a Astika system. Astika system means it is an orthodox system. What does it mean? Astika system is that which accepts the authority of the Vedas. So, what is a moral action? Moral action is that which is in accordance with the injunctions of the Vedas. And immoral action is that which goes against the injunction of the Vedas. Here we have to see how Vaisheshika system is allied to Vedas, though it looks as if it is a materialistic philosophy or purely talking about atoms and all that. It is Astika, and also it is theistic. It is also theistic system. Theistic system in the sense it is accepting the existence of God. God is also given the place as an eternal atom. So merits and demerits of the individual make up the unseen power that is called Adrishta, otherwise known as karma. So one has to reap the fruits of actions one has performed. If we perform good actions, we reap, good results. If we perform bad actions, we receive bad fruits. And depending on that, we get into suffering or get into liberation. So good karmas result in pleasure and the bad karmas in pain. This is the law of karma, the unseen power. This power, guided by God, imparts motion to the atoms and leads to the creation of world, the enjoyment and suffering of the individual souls. But the soul will remain bound as long as it is performing actions. So, as it is the case with all Indian philosophies, liberation means not having any action. You become inactive in the sense you are not participating in the world of daily activities like many others. It is a kind of resignation from the world. So it is only by stopping to act that the soul can overcome the bondage, because the very act causes demeritorious actions, according to Vaisheshika. Liberation comes through knowledge, and bondage is due to actions leading to the cessation of suffering. And when actions stop, new merits and demerits do not get accumulated. Old merits and demerits also gradually disappear, and soul gets separated from the fetters of the mind and body. Because it is through the mind and body that we perform actions, liberation means the soul should become liberated from mind and also the body and also the sense organs. It ultimately realizes its own pure nature. There is a pure nature for the soul, and pure nature is a kind of nishkriya, that is inaction. And it is not influenced by anything that is outside. It is not influenced even with its own body. It becomes completely independent of its body, mind and senses, and also the objects in the external world. So it is a state of substance. It's a state of substance which is devoid of all qualities, including bliss. See, this is the peculiarity that we have to bear in mind. In Vaisheshika, liberation doesn't mean joy. It means only cessation of suffering or pain. You cannot expect that you will be very happy, you will be jumping and you will be very joyful in the state of liberation, because joy is also part of the actions. Therefore, when there is no action, there is no joy also. So this is the way that Vaisheshikas describe the state of liberation, and soul is completely devoid of all the characteristics, all the qualities, because every characteristic is accidental only. It is not essential, it is not inherent in the soul. They have come from outside. So therefore, in liberation, all these qualities, all these actions may go out of the soul. Soul becomes a pure existence. And they are acquired by the soul when it is embodied. What qualities and actions? It is only in embodied state that soul acquires. In liberation, they cease to exist, because the soul now is not associated with the mind and body, as I have already said. Vaisheshika characterizes liberation as the cessation of all life also, all consciousness, all bliss, including pain and other qualities. Liberation is an indeterminate pure nature which is qualityless. We can't talk about state of liberation at all, because it is without all qualities. And it signifies the individual soul, which is pure substance without quality and action. In liberation, the liberated soul remains in its own peculiar individuality and particularity, and it remains without knowing, feeling, or doing anything. And as a matter of summary, we can say that there are some critical remarks that have been passed by other systems, that is, realistic pluralism of the Vaisheshika is only a common sense explanation of this universe. It is not very philosophical. Everybody knows that there is matter all over this universe, and there are atoms are there. So this is a commonsensical philosophy, but not a very profound philosophy. At best, it may be regarded as a scientific system or a scientific explanation or the analysis of this world. This is the criticism leveled against the Vaisheshika system. It only gives a catalogue of categories, substances. And it doesn't synthesize them. There is no effort to synthesize all these, padarthas and dravyas, that is, categories and substances should be interlinked so that you can show that here is a profound system which is highly philosophical, but that is not there in the system. The system is not a synthetic philosophy. This is what they say, because it treats categories as ultimate and their objects which are independent of each other. At the same time, it treats categories such as action and quality as being independent and at the same time dependent upon the category of substance. See, this is the contradiction that we find in how can action at the same time independent substance and at the same time you say that it is dependent on the first category called substance. So categories like universality, particularity and inherence cannot be treated as substances because they are concepts dependent more on thought. You see, universality we cannot see, therefore how can you say that it is a category? So also particularity and inference. Also the category of non-existence is relative. You cannot take it as an independent padartha, as I have already said at the beginning of the lesson. Non-existence is relative only, and it is intelligible only as being related to the existence, and so it cannot be regarded as being absolute. And category of substance cannot also be regarded as being absolute, for it cannot be known in the absence of its qualities and relations. So this is another important point that we have to bear in mind. Any substance, can we know it independently of its qualities and actions? The moment we see a substance or any object, we see or we come to know that subject only through its qualities. I say it is red. I say it is soft. I say it is sweet. It is only through these qualities that I am able to know the substance. So therefore, can we say that substance is there independent of these qualities? That is another contradiction that Vaisheshikas have to answer. And it reduces itself to mere nothing in the absence of its qualities and relations, which means substance. If there is no qualities and relations, substance reduces itself, nothing, we can't say anything about it. So the realistic pluralism of the Vaisheshika involves above contradictions, and its explanations are arguments in defense of their position are also defective. It is a more commonsensical thinking and not a very consistent philosophy. So these are the, some of the critical remarks that we can note by way of summary. However, Vaisheshika system has contributed largely to the importance of Indian philosophy because it has tried to categorize the entire world into various kinds of categories and substances. That is why the Vaisheshika philosophy has its own importance, even though there are some, contradictions or some defects in the entire system. Thank you very much.